This is Duke University.
us, Lord, linger near when my life is almost gone. Hear my cry, hear my call. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Lead me
Grace to you and peace in the name of Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship this morning. A special thanks goes to the Amalgam Brass Ensemble for providing additional music today. This morning is bittersweet for us because it's the last Sunday that our Dean Sam Wells will be with us before returning to England. And we have a day full of farewell events designed to celebrate the Wells family. There will be a lunch after service. We invite you to join us for this. There are 1,500 lunches ordered, so please help us eat them. In order to facilitate an expeditious lunch, however, Dean Wells will not be shaking hands at the back of the church, as is custom. So instead, we encourage you to go directly outside and grab a lunch. I've been told that if it's raining, you're welcome to bring those back in, which will actually help the program at 1:15 start on time. You might want, if it's not raining, if the weather's nice, you might want to keep an eye on your watches so that you can come back in here and find a seat, because that will begin at 1:15. Also, please note that there will be no worship here next Sunday. The congregation will be worshiping with Antioch Baptist Church, but due to the university commencement ceremonies, worship will not be taking place here in the chapel. The processional hymn is printed in the back of your bulletin, and this represents an inspired and holy union because Sam Wells wrote the text for this Sunday and Martin Luther provided the music. So I invite you to please stand and sing praises to God.
God makes his grace heard in silence, touch, and word. And yet we ignore this grace and offer of friendship, and we prefer to follow our own paths. Let us confess our sins to our loving God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you to himself, cleanse you from all of your sins, and strengthen you to live in the power of the Holy Spirit all of your days. As a forgiven and reconciled people, let us share signs and words of Christ's peace.
When Sam Wells was installed as Dean of Duke Chapel in September 2005, we charged him to be among us in a variety of ways. In the last 7 years, he has been among us in those ways and others. In remembrance of that charge and in tribute to how he has performed it, we've asked members of the Duke and Durham communities to bring forward symbols of his leadership.
You have been among us as one who has spoken the truth.
You have been among us as one who's brought transformation in the form of baptismal waters.
You have been among us as one who has taught in ways that we could understand.
You have been among us as one who has made the heart sing with God's praise.
You have been among us as one who has made us God's companions.
You have been among us as one who has helped us unite the traditions of eruditio and religio.
You have been among us as one who has helped us to tell the truth about our past.
You have been among us as one who has helped us enter the future with courage and wisdom.
You have been among us as one who has shown us how to live in peace.
You have been among us as one who has played and enjoyed the play of others.
You've been among us as one who has shone with the light of the risen Jesus.
Heavenly Father, you have given us flourishing life together in speech and song and story and sacrament, in witness and wisdom and in wonder. Bless this community in the next era of its life, that we may still know you through your Son as your companions and continue to discover the Spirit in friend and stranger. Amen.
Please join me for the prayer of illumination printed in your bulletin. Risen Christ, your wounds declare your love for the world and the wonder of your risen life. Inspire us now through your word and give us compassion and courage to risk ourselves for those we serve. To the glory of God the Father. Amen. The first lesson is from 1 John, the fourth chapter. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from John, the 15th chapter. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Jesus hasn't got long left with his disciples, so he gathers them round for one last conversation. And you feel the disciples' growing sense of panic, because suddenly that wondrous abundance that they'd always felt around Jesus is being displaced by a terrifying sense of scarcity, that they don't have him for much longer. And the disciples are saying, "Show us more. You haven't told us enough." But at the same time, Jesus is saying, "I've shown you all there is." To say or to do more would simply be showing you or telling you more of what you've already heard and seen. It's as if Jesus has reached into his extensive collection of 1980s soul albums and started singing, "If you don't know me by now, you will never, never, never know me." To which the disciples' only appropriate response is, "Ooh." All behind the one microphone, you understand. What Jesus does is to give them one last "I am" saying. He's given six already, including, "I am the resurrection and the life, I am the good shepherd, and I am the way, the truth, and the life." And now he's going to make it the perfect seven. He says, "I am the true vine." Think about how many layers of significance there are in this phrase. Israel thought of itself as a vine, or at least a vineyard. Jesus is saying, I am the true Israel, the chosen of God, through whom all the nations will find a blessing. Jesus says, I am the trunk, the core, the epicenter of everything God has always been doing. Remember, it all started with a tree in a garden. Humanity's failure to honor that tree symbolized humanity's failure to put God in the middle of all things and let God be the source of abundant life. Jesus says, I am the heart of it all. I am the original source of life. I am God's renewal of the earth through Israel. And now here we are, the night before Jesus is hung on the cross, and Jesus is describing himself as a tree. Surely no coincidence there, you'd think. Jesus is saying, this tree is what I am. I am God's arms stretched abroad to rescue Israel, to restore Israel, humanity, and all creation to life, and to turn the water of life into the wine of eternal life. My Father is pruning me, curtailing my life, to give the fruit of abundant life to the world. And the word Jesus uses no less than 8 times in 4 short verses is abide. It's also used 6 times in 4 verses in today's epistle from the first letter of John. Abide in me. Abide in me the way I abide in the Father. In other words, stay connected to the vine. Stay with these things. If you want a shorthand for who I am, says Jesus, remember the vine. Because the root of the vine is Israel. The branches of the vine are the church. The grapes of the vine are abundant life. The fruit of the vine and the work of human hands is the cup of the Eucharist. The transformation of earthy water into heavenly wine is the work of the Holy Spirit, and the trunk of the vine is Jesus. It's all here. Stay close to the vine, says Jesus. If you don't know me in the vine, you will never, never, never know me. Abide with me in the vine, and you will be at the heart of it all. The 2005 movie, The Notebook, portrays an old man driving to a care home to see a woman who lives there. In flashback, we discover the story of an unlikely romance. Noah is a country boy. Ali is from the city. Noah doesn't have 2 dimes to rub together. Ali's dad has more money than God. It's the South in the 1940s. There's no way old wealth is going to be allowed to marry white trash. Ali's mother knows it can only end with her daughter heartbroken or pregnant. So Ali's spirited north to another world, to New York, to college, where in time she meets just the right young man and becomes engaged. Noah never gets over the summer romance. Instead, he puts his heart and soul into restoring the dilapidated house where he and Ali first embraced all those years before. While trying on her wedding dress, Ali reads about Noah's restoration enterprise in the local newspaper. Out of curiosity, she drives out to see the old familiar house. It's like putting a match to a powder keg. The romance reignites within moments of Noah and Ali setting eyes on each other again. It's time for Ali to choose. Ali faces a choice that will define her life. And at this point, we understand who the old man driving to the care home was. And we realize what he was driving there to do. He's Noah, 60 years later, except now he goes by another name, an interesting name. He goes by the name Duke. And he's carrying in his hand a notebook. It turns out it's a notebook written by Ali at a point in her life when she'd realized the bindweed of Alzheimer's was beginning to wrap itself around her brain. And we perceive what the story is really about. Every day, Duke comes to the care home to read the story back to her. When he gets to the defining moment in the story, the moment when it's time for Ali to choose, Duke stops reading and, like a good storyteller, lets the listener do the work. He turns to Ali and says, "Which one did she choose?" For an exquisite moment, past and present coalesce, and Ali, in a flash of perception, comes to her senses, then and now. In that moment, she knows who she is. And in that same moment, I know who I am. In this very moment, right now, I know who I am. I'm telling you the story of a woman who came to her senses when she was told the story in the right way. And it's an old story, but it feels new. Maybe it really is new. Because, don't you see, that's what I do. That's what I do. I'm a preacher. That's what a preacher does. A preacher learns the song in your heart and sings it back to you when you forget how it goes. A preacher learns the song in God's heart and sings it to you in rhythm, in classical, in blues, in soul, in rock, and sometimes even in roll. A preacher comes to you when you're confused, when you're on your knees, when you're bewildered, when you're hard of hearing, when you're in a faraway land of fairies or a dungeon of defeated desire. A preacher comes to you and tells you the story again until you realize that the one in the story left with a choice is you. God is like Noah, preparing a place for you, crazy with love for you, abiding with you even when you're dallying with Southern society and dominated by your family's blinkered notions of your welfare. And you are like Ali, forgetful of your soul, suppressing your sadness, pretending you're acting for the best. And God sings to you, be you 9 or 19 or 49 or 99, "If you don't know me by now, you will never, never, never know me." And the preacher says, "Ali, which one did you choose?" And your eyes fill with tears, and you say, "God. I chose God. I chose God then, and I choose God now." and you come to your senses, and you come face to face with God. And whether you're experiencing Alzheimer's or depression, or bereavement or despair or loneliness or failure or fear, you come alive like never before, and you stretch out your hand to your precious Lord and ask him to lead you home and say those simple, joyful words, "Abide with me." I stand before you today with only one thing to say. The words my mother taught me to say when it was time to say goodbye, whether I meant them or not. Thank you for having me. I've had a lovely time. But this time it really is true. Thank you. Thank you because after 7 precious years of abiding with you, 7 years of sharing a story and seeing it come alive and bring people alive, 7 years of dear old Duke, I realize that I'm not Noah. I'm not the one who's been telling the story. I'm Ali. I'm Ali, the one who half remembers the defining choice of her life, the one who lapses into forgetfulness, the one who's surrounded by love but still finds a way to fall into fear. And you, my colleagues on faculty and staff, you, chapel congregation with a big C and a little C, you, Pathways students and public policy students, you divinity students and Anglican Episcopal students and doctoral students, you attenders at vigils and families of homicide victims, you chapel choir and Vespers ensemble, you friends and alums and administrators and trustees, you watchers of webcasts and emailers from New Zealand and the Outer Hebrides and Vancouver and Taiwan, you Muslim, Jew, Buddhist, Hindu, you friends in Durham Public Schools and businesses and the police and nonprofits and NCCU and partner churches, you who sleep outside and eat in the soup kitchen, you in whom I've met eruditio and in whom I've met religio, you guys, you-ans, y'all, all y'all. You and Noah. Except, of course, in the story, Duke and Noah turn out to be the same person. You've been Duke for me. And today I realize you've been Noah all along. You've sung to me the song in God's heart. And today I'm like the disciples at the Last Supper, feeling that the glorious abundance of these last 7 years together is about to be displaced by the terrifying scarcity of parting, and I'm wanting to say, it's not enough. Why can't there be more? And I feel you singing. If you don't know us by now, you will never, never, never know us. Together we've seen branches grow and bear fruit. Together we've experienced the abundance of the Father's harvest. Together we've known times of pruning and the grief and anger and horror and bewilderment of losing a branch and all the fruit we believed could have come from it. Together we've seen earth turn into grapes. the water of life turn into the wine of eternal life. Together we've said to Jesus, abide with us. And you know what? I do believe he has. I've been with you as a preacher, and I've discovered you know the song in God's heart better than I do, and you've been singing it to me these last 7 years. But there's something more important, more basic, more fundamental than being a preacher, and that's being a disciple. And of all the people who might be Duke, or shall we say Noah, in your life, and tell you the story in such a way that brings to you to your senses, the most likely of all is a child. I want now to close the notebook by telling you about one day a preacher discovered what the vine really is and what it means to abide in Jesus through the wisdom of a child. I'm going to tell you about a family I know very well, and you know very well. The children are quite young, not 10 years old. They've attended a well-known and very large church for most of their lives. The children's father's a well-known preacher, but the two children aren't at all impressed by that. They know what really matters. When they see the procession of choir and Bible and servers and lectors and clergy walk forward during the opening hymn, the children are captivated by the one thing that really matters, the one thing that encapsulates the vine in all its life-giving abundance and transforming power and pruning grief, and that one thing is the cross. One of the children habitually takes a small cross out of her worship bag and waves it proudly as the choir and Bible and clergy walk by. One day, while everyone else was singing the processional hymn, her brother decided right now was the time to ask their mother for the answers to life's most important questions. What does it take to carry the cross, Mummy? You have to be strong, son, because it's heavy and you have to carry it a long way. But most people find that it gets lighter because Jesus promised to bear the burden with us. Who gets to carry the cross, Mummy? It's often a member of the choir, son, because to be in the choir, you have to be incredibly strong. But really, anyone can be invited to do it. Might I carry the cross one day, Mummy? I hope so, son. I hope you'll carry it every day of your life. Will Daddy ever get to carry the cross? Maybe he will, son. Maybe one day he will. I came here to be your preacher, and you have made me a disciple. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God who abides with us, you stand among us and tell us your story. Help us to come to our senses so that your story becomes our story and that the song of your heart becomes the song of our hearts. Make us a community shaped by your cross. When discipleship feels a burden, bear with us and carry us along this journey. Hold close to your heart any who are in the midst of crises today. Free from anguish, any struggling with depression, bereavement, or despair. Awaken with your grace those who feel broken by their loneliness, their failures, and their fear. Make your presence known to any who once felt they could hear your voice and sing your song, but now find only silence. We bring before you any who have seen their lives and livelihoods fall apart and struggle to know how to move forward. Pour your comfort on the people of Syria, Sudan and South Sudan, Iraq and Afghanistan. Lord, in your mercy. God who walks with us, we give you thanks for the 7 years of ministry of Sam Wells. We are so grateful that you allowed his life to intersect with ours. We name with thanksgiving the many things that we have loved and cherished about Sam: wise leadership, gentle kindness, gracious mentorship, dry wit, and faithful proclamation. Be with Sam as he prepares for his new appointment at St. Martin's in the Fields. We pray for friendships and joy yet to be discovered, and that you would continue to reveal yourself through him at his new church. Prepare Sam and strengthen him for the work you have in store. We name before you Joe, Lawrence, and Stephanie, that they too will discover your gracious life in London, that they will be surrounded by companionship, vocation, and learning. Lord, in your mercy. God who guides our future as you have our past, we pray your peace and comfort on Duke Chapel in this time of transition. Increase our faith in the midst of uncertainty and loss. Hold our community close to your heart and prepare us to welcome the gifts and ministry of whoever will be our new dean. Pour your mercy over all who are most closely affected by Sam's parting. We name before you the search committee and the president of the university and ask your wisdom and discernment be clear in the coming months. Bless this university and the Durham community and this chapel with a future leader of faithfulness, vision, and wisdom. And continually prepare us to be a sanctuary of grace, love, and truth. Lord, in your mercy. Be still our souls when dearest friends depart and all is darkened in the veil of tears. Help us to better know your love, your heart, and soothe our sorrow and our fears. Amen. Today's offering will go to the chapel's Pathways program, which is the way we develop relationships with undergraduate students. Let us offer our gifts to the one who has given to us so graciously.
Thank you. If you are here today feeling weary and heavy laden about a person or an issue that's heavy on your heart, ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right during the sharing of communion. They'd be glad to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Abiding God, you planted the vineyard of creation and called your people Israel to be your vine, rooted and grounded in you. In Jesus, you gave us the true vine, turning earth into grapes and the water of life into the wine of eternal life. Through your Son, you abide in us, and in the power of your Holy Spirit, you shape the branches of the vine to make fruit that will last. In this meal of creation, of resurrection, and of everlasting life, you pour out the wine of your abundance to give us eternal joy in you. And so we gladly thank you, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending praise. Transforming God, your Son took the ordinary substance of human flesh and bone, and on his last night with his friends, he took the ordinary materials of bread and wine. Come among us now and take the ordinariness of our lives and make them glow with the wonder of your eternal life. Take these gifts of bread and wine and make them be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread and gave it to them saying, take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup also, gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Companionable God, you turn word into flesh, and your perfect love casts out our fear. You give us a way to love you by giving us brothers and sisters to love as we love you. Abide with all whose lives are far from fruitful. Remain with those who have experienced pruning. Dwell with any who feel like branches that have been discarded. Unite your whole church, living and departed, as branches of your one vine, and through being rooted and grounded in you, make us fruitful in body, mind, and spirit, until we stand before you with your whole creation, and you are all in all, one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God's love is revealed among us in this way. In Jesus, God came to abide with us. Come to this table to abide with God.
Thank you.
Please stand. Gracious Father, you sustain us with the gifts of bread and wine, your Son's body and blood. We thank you for your abundant mercy, your abiding presence, and your endless love. Make the bread of life you've given strengthen and nourish us in body and soul, that in word and deed we might proclaim your abiding love in the world. We rejoice in the life you've offered us by connecting us to the vine of your Son. And we praise you for uniting us together as the branch of your church. May the offerings gathered this morning represent the fruit we bear, returned for your good pleasure. Turn the grapes of our life together into the wine that enraptures all people into wonder, awe, and praise of you, ever one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated.
Sam, Joe, Lawrence, and Stephanie, go from this place enveloped by God's love and share God's love with others as you have shared it with us.
Go from this place in peace and bring peace to all whom you meet on the way.
Go from this place in truth and speak the truth to all who long to hear it.
Go from this place with God's blessing, and may you be a blessing to all who know you as you have been to us.
Go from this place carrying the cross of Christ, and carry the promise that our shepherd gently leads you and will continue to lead us.
You have opened the heart of God to us, and we have sung God's heart back to you. Now God is calling you to a new flock. God's heart goes with you. Our hearts go with you. You came to us as strangers, but to part as beloved friends. And we shall gather again in the heart of God. Amen.
Now may you go from this place as disciples, singing the song of God's abiding with us to all who will listen. And may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.